Yashoda Dula Govinda Gopala Vrindavana Purana. Transcendental Diary by Harisori Prabhu, Sridhar Mayapur. This is November 75 to April 76. A letter came from Sweden, written by Dwarakesh Das. In it, he explained that he was a Hungarian who had escaped from Hungary several years ago, later becoming a devotee. Now the Hungarian government was allowing illegal immigrants back, although once returning, it would be difficult to get out again. he felt he should go back and attempt to deliver Krishna consciousness to his countrymen. The devotees in Sweden already had contacts with a yoga club there, and he was enthusiastic to preach. Prabhupada encouraged him. After so many recent conversations and discussions on communism, it seemed like Krishna responding to Srila Prabhupada's desire to spread Krishna consciousness in the communist countries. If there is possibility to preach among the communists, he wrote, you must do it immediately. The intelligent communist people will very easily understand our philosophy. We can convince them on the basis of Sama Sarveshu Bhuteshu, a Krishna conscious person is equally disposed to every living entity. He explained that communism is no better than capitalism because both exploit the animals and other living beings. Prabhupada told Dwarakesh he should make the present imperfect idea of communism perfect by following the description of perfect communism given in Srimad Bhagavatam. It is stated that you feel for the poor animals as well as the human beings. Srimad Bhagavatam instructs that even if there is a snake or a lizard in the house, it is the duty of the householder to see that they are also eating, not starving. So you have to begin your preaching with such broader idea of communism. So far as coming out of Hungary, once you enter, if you can preach, what is the need of coming out? Mahamsa Swami wrote, he's having difficulty persuading the two sisters in Nellore to relax the conditions on the deed of the gift of land. Prabhupada responded, we are not at all interested to be dictated by them. He told him that because we have already installed the foundation stone, we do not wish to go back. To this end, he stated his willingness even to purchase the land and still allow the two ladies to carry on living in one portion of the building. As devotees, Srila Prabhupada was adamant though that we shall not concede to any special conditions. So, preaching in communist countries, I wanted to ask, maybe somebody knows, Prabhupada says here, he's written here, Srimad Bhagavatam instructs that even if there is a snake or a lizard in the house, you should feed it. You should not be starving. A snake. So usually it says you should kill the snake, right? So you can kill the snake.
Cannot.
Cannot.
We need the poison.
She said we need the poison or vaccine. Oh. That's why don't you take care.
Well, there's a pastime. There is a statement there in the Bhagavatam also that if there's a snake, you can kill it. But Prabhupada told, he saw one time in Mayapur, right, that the snake in Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati said, kill it! Yeah. And Prabhupada was shocked at first. But then he read in the Bhagavatam where it says that if there's a snake, you can kill it. More rats. That's right, snakes are envious, that's why they're supposed to be killed.
Human beings are more envious.
Hiranyakashipu got killed, right? Okay. Just have to leave this one. Complex. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam namaskrityam.
Narayanam namaskrityam.
Naram chaiva narottamam.
Naram chaiva narottamam.
Daivim sarasatim vyasam.
Daivim sarasatim vyasam.
Tato jayamudirayat.
Tato jayamudirayat.
Inastaprayeshu vabhadreshu.
Inastaprayeshu vabhadreshu.
Nityam bhagavata sevaya.
Nityam bhagavata
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke.
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke.
Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki.
Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki.
We're reading Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 4, Chapter Number 3. Talks between Lord Shiva and Sati. Text Number 19. Tataridhir.
Tataridhir.
Na.
Na.
Yatate,
yatate,
silimukai,
silimukai,
sete,
arditango,
redayena,
redayena,
duyuta,
duyuta,
swanam,
swanam,
yata,
yata,
vakra,
vakra,
viyam. Duruktibir Diva Nisham Tapam Tapyati Marnam Marma Tadita
Marma Tadita
Tataridhir navyatate salimukai.
Tataridhir navyatate salimukai.
Tataridhitango ridayena dayata.
Tataridhitango ridayena dayata.
Svanam yata vakra diyam. Duruk tibi
Svanamyata vakramya duruk tibi
Devanisham tapyati marmavtadisa
Devanisham tapyati marmavtadisa
Tataribhirna vyatate silimukai
Tataribhirna
Sate riditango ridayena dayata.
Sate riditango ridayena dayata.
Svanam yata vyakra diyam duruktibhi.
Svanam yata vyakra diyam duruktibhi.
Devanikam tapyati marmav. Tadita
Nivanisham Tathyati Mahatadita
Tataridhirna Vyatate Silimukai
Tataridhirna Vyatate Silimukai
Sate Riditango Vidayena Duyata
Sate Riditango Vidayena Duyata
Svanam Yata Vakradiyam Duruk Divanisham tapyati marmatadita
Divanisham tapyati marmatadita Tadibir tavyatate silimukai
Tata.
Tata.
So.
So.
Aribe.
Aribe.
Enemy.
Enemy.
Na.
Na.
Not.
Not.
Yatate.
Yatate.
Is hurt.
Is hurt.
Silly Mukai.
Silly Mukai.
By the arrows.
By the arrows.
Sete.
Sete.
Rest.
Rest.
Ardita.
Ardita.
Aggrieve.
Aggrieve.
Angaha.
Angaha.
Apart.
Apart.
Ridayena.
Ridayena.
By the heart.
By the heart.
Dayata.
Dayata.
Grieving.
Grieving.
Swanam.
Swanam.
Of relatives.
Of relatives.
Yata.
Yata.
As. Bhakratiyam.
Bhakratiyam.
Deceitful.
Deceitful.
Duruktibi.
Duruktibi.
By harsh words.
By harsh words.
Divanisham.
Divanisham.
Day and night.
Day and night.
Tapyati.
Tapyati.
Suffers.
Suffers.
Marmatadita.
Marmatadita.
One whose feelings are hurt.
One whose feelings are hurt.
Translation. Lord Shiva continued, if one is hurt by the arrows of an enemy, one is not as aggrieved as when cut by the unkind words of a relative. For such grief continues to rend one's heart day and night. You can all repeat. Lord Shiva continued.
Lord Shiva continued.
If one is hurt,
if one is hurt
by the arrows of an enemy,
by the arrows of an enemy,
one is not as aggrieved,
one is not as aggrieved
as when cut.
As when cut
by the unkind words,
by the unkind words
of a relative.
Of a relative.
For such grief,
that
continues to rend
one's heart day and night.
Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Sati might have concluded that she would take the risk of going to her father's house, and even if her father spoke unkindly against her, she would be tolerant, as a son sometimes tolerates the reproaches of his parents. But Lord Shiva reminded her that she would not be able to tolerate such unkind words, because natural psychology dictates that although one can suffer harm from an enemy and not mind so much, because pain inflicted by an enemy is natural, when one is hurt by the strong words of a relative, one suffers the effects continually, day and night. And sometimes the injury becomes so intolerable that one commits suicide. Om Ajnana Timurandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Taksurumilitanyena Tasmai Shri Guruve Nama Manchakaupatarubhyasya Kripa Sindhu Vaivacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Nama Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So, Lord Shiva had some difficulty with the in-laws. Quite a common thing, right? Those of you who are married, you know about that, how difficult it is with the in-laws. Trying to get along. Those who are brahmacharis, we don't have to worry about that. Not a problem. But married life, in-laws, oh, very big problems. So Sati's problem was she wanted to go to her father's yajna, her father, Daksha,
he's a Prajapati, and he liked to perform yajñas, and he would invite many people. Yajña is a social function in the higher planets. Just like on this planet, there's social functions like marriages and parties. So in the higher planets, the social function, when the demigods perform some yajña, then everyone will come. And, you know, social functions, people, the ladies like to dress up, they like to be seen. But Lord Shiva is telling Sati that we shouldn't go. It's not good to go. Because Lord Shiva had already experienced some difficulty there with Daksha. The Daksha took offense against Lord Shiva because Lord Shiva did not offer respects, didn't offer obeisances of respects to Daksha. And, you know, of course, father-in-law, you know, son, come, you know, should have some respect, right? Just like daughter-in-law with the mother and father, they have to show some respect. Sometimes difficult situations. Anyway, Lord Shiva was naturally, Lord Shiva is a great Vaishnava. He's always meditating on the Lord. So he was in meditation on the Lord, and when Daksha came, he did not offer respects to him. So Daksha took offense that my son-in-law is not respecting me. And he became quite nasty towards Lord Shiva, so much so that he took Lord Shiva's name out of the offerings. Usually when they perform yajna, they have to make different offerings to the different demigods. And Lord Shiva would also get some offerings, but Daksha told the priests that you don't offer anything for Shiva. Don't offer anything for him. And so, after that, Lord Shiva decided no point to go anymore to these yajñas. Daksha doesn't have a nice mood. So Lord Shiva didn't want to go. But when the next yajña came up, then Sati, his wife, wanted to go. And Lord Shiva is telling her, not very wise to go. If you do go, you're going to get insulted. As it's described here, that words can be more painful than arrows. The arrows are inflicted generally by the enemy. So the words of an enemy are not, so, you know, you can tolerate that because you know, well, he's the enemy, we're inimical, we don't have a good relationship. But in terms of relatives, if the relatives will be nasty or say something harsh or unkind, then it's even more painful. And of course we see this several times in the Bhagavatam, right? This problem with the in-laws and family relatives. You've got Devaki, just being married to Vasudeva, and Kamsa was pulling the chariot. But when that voice from the sky said that, oh, the eighth child of this girl Devaki is going to kill you, then Kamsa was immediately ready to kill Devaki. And it was only by the political words of Vasudeva that he could be somewhat pacified. And Vasudeva promised that, don't worry, I'll give you all of the children. Whenever she delivers a child, I will give it to you. So that satisfied Kamsa. So that was one incident. The in-law, brother Kamsa, is the brother of Devaki, but he's ready to kill her. And then you've got other incidents, like, of course, the battle of Kurukshetra. That's also another family affair. The two sides, the Kuravas and the Pandavas. Now the Pandavas are also Kuravas, but they can't get along. You cannot get them to put them together. Doesn't work. So this problem, the family relationships, very difficult. Speaking words, unkind words to each other. This is symptoms of the lower modes of nature. When we speak harshly and unkind, the symptoms of the demon are described in Bhagavad Gita, and it's mentioned there how the demonic who speak words which are often very harsh. So the demons are related to the modes of passion and ignorance. However, on the mode of goodness, where the devotee and the Brahmins are expected to be situated, the quality of the mode of goodness is to speak words which are pleasing and at the same time truthful. That's also important. So Prabhupada explains that devotees, we are meant for speaking the truth. Sometimes it may be pleasing, sometimes may not. But we have to learn also to be able to speak it in such a way that it is palatable.
And there was the Sanskrit, the famous Sanskrit saying, Satyam Bruyat Priyam Bruyat. That it said to speak the truth and at the same time make it pleasing.
So, Prabhupada, we had a problem, of course, that came up one time with the Back to Godhead magazine, when they published the article about Vallabha Acharya, where Lord Chaitanya said something about Vallabha Acharya, that your words are like the unchaste wife. So, because Vallabha Acharya had written his commentary on Vedanta, or on Srimad Bhagavatam. And he came with his commentary and he was very proud of it and he wanted everyone to hear it. And he was even saying that my commentary is better than Sridhar Swami's commentary. Now Sridhar Swami is the original commentator on the Srimad Bhagavatam and he is called Swami. But husband is also called Swami, right? So Lord Chaitanya took that to point to correct Vallabha Acharya. And he told Vallabha Acharya that when one writes something, the etiquette is that you don't try to surpass the previous Acharyas. And to try to surpass the previous Acharya is considered unchaste. So Vallabha Acharya was making a mistake in etiquette there by saying that my commentary is better than even Swami's, than even Sridhar Swami's. So Lord Chaitanya said when a woman is unfaithful to her husband, then that's like a prostitute, that's unchaste. A woman should be faithful to her husband. Swami means husband. So Lord Chaitanya took Sridhar Swami and made it into the husband and said to Vallabha Acharya, you should be faithful. You should not try to surpass the word of Sridhar Swami. So this is all told in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. And that section from the Chaitanya Charitamrita, somehow it came to be published in the Back to Godhead magazine. Now Back to Godhead magazine gets, at least used to be widely circulated, used to go to life members. And life members, would look through it, and somehow one of the life members happened to be a follower of Pushtimarg. And Pushtimarg means Vallabha Acharya Sampradaya. Vallabha Acharya, he was a friend of Lord Chaitanya, but he took initiation from the Shiva, Lord Shiva's Sampradaya, and that line of coming from Lord Shiva. And today it's called Pushtimarg. And they have their own
temples, and they even take care of the puja for Srinathji. If you find the temples of Srinathji, usually they're done by Pushtimar. Just like you go to Dubai, in Dubai they have the temple there, Nathji temple. And the puja is all done by Brahmanas from the Pushtimar. And they do very nice puja, and they sing lots of songs about Vrindavan. And they worship Krishna as a child, as a young child, Bala, in the Bala form. And they, you know, just like you have a child, you will cook milk sweets, and you'll give the child little sweet rice, and, you know, very easy to digest food. So they cook like that. And they sing, you know, they have swing and everything. And they make many nice festivals for in the mood of Vrindavan. They sing all these beautiful songs about Krishna's pastimes. So that deity of Srinathji, of course, it was originally found by Madhavendra Puri. So Madhavendra Puri is in our line of Sampradaya. But it happened that the deity worship was given to the two sons of Ballabha Acharya. Ballabha Acharya had a couple of sons who were also very, very good devotees. And so when there was at one point, for some reason, the deity was given to them, and then the deity ended up over in Nathdwara, Rajasthan, corner of Rajasthan in Gujarat, there, Nathdwara, where it's protected. So, Ballabha Acharya, he has his sampradaya, has many followers, and mostly they're Gujarati people. Ballabha Acharya is actually from South India, but somehow his following is all up there in Gujarat. And you see a lot of Gujarati people, they all say, Jai Shri Krishna. Some of them say Hare Krishna. Usually it's Jai Shri Krishna. So they got the deity, and this magazine got in the hands of people from Pushtimar, and they read it, and they were not happy. Because according to them, Ballabha Acharya is called Mahaprabhu. Just like Lord Chaitanya for us, Lord Chaitanya is Mahaprabhu. For them, Mahaprabhu is Ballabha Acharya. And he's a great scholar, and he wrote wonderful commentaries on Srimad Bhagavatam. And sometimes Prabhupada would quote them also in his purports. So they got that magazine, and then some of them knew that this lady who sent Prabhupada to America, Srimati Morariji, who has this India shipping company, she's also from Pushtimar. She's in that same line, that same sampradaya. So they told her that, look at this, you sent this Swamiji to America, and look what he's done. He's telling all this about our Mahaprabhu. He's telling everybody about Mahaprabhu, that our Mahaprabhu is like this. So she was not pleased, of course. I mean, the Pushtimar people were on her case, you know. You did it. You're the one. You sent him to America. You put him on your ship. You gave him the chance to go to America. Look what he's done. They were not, you know. So she wrote to Prabhupada, and she asked Prabhupada, why like this? You know, why your people did like this? So at that time, then Prabhupada quoted that saying, Satyam Bruyat Priyam Bruyat. And Prabhupada apologized on behalf of the editors of the Back to Godhead magazine. He said, you have to forgive my disciples that they don't know this etiquette, that if you're going to speak the truth, you must make it pleasing. So, but Prabhupada then went on to explain. He said, actually, when Lord Chaitanya said like this to Ballabha Acharya, it was said in a nice way.
Balabhacharya didn't take it as an offense. He didn't get upset or angry, because Balabhacharya and Lord Chaitanya were very friendly relationship. And Balabhacharya also had great respect for Lord Chaitanya. When Lord Chaitanya had gone to Triveni, Balabhacharya had brought Lord Chaitanya to his house. There's one big house there at, just not far from the Triveni, which is Kushti Mart today. It's still their center. So Lord Chaitanya had gone there. You can read in the Chaitanya Charitamrita how Lord Chaitanya got on the boat and they crossed the boat and they crossed the Ganga. But when they came to the Yamuna side, the water there is very dark. And Lord Chaitanya became ecstatic and he fell in the Ganga. He fell into the water. And Balabhacharya was shocked. He'd never seen anybody with so much ecstasy. He could understand, you know, Lord Chaitanya is a very, very great personality, divine personality. So he had great respect for Lord Chaitanya. So Prabhupada pointed out that Balabhacharya did not take any offense to this, that they were there in a friendly relationship. But Prabhupada told the editors of the magazine, you must be more careful in future, that when you put things into the magazine, you have to be very careful and sensitive about what you're putting. You don't want to offend people. So it's this issue, you know, if you say words are also like a weapon, like there's one word shastra, which is a book, and the other word shastra is a sword or the weapon. I heard when Arandam was going around, they would ask people, they'd go to the Brahmin, do you want the Quran or do you, which shastra do you want, you know? The Quran or the sword? Both are shastra. One shastra is shastra. If you don't take the Quran, off with your head, you know? And every day so many Brahmin prayers were brought to Arantip, right? So that shastra. Shastra, the weapon, and shastra, the book. So words, very powerful. We have to be very careful how we use the words. We just saw in the north, right? So up in the north, in some centers, some devotees, sometimes they use words which are very unpleasant, and devotees take great offense and spoke, use this word, so nasty word to use this word. Very serious thing. And so, how important it is to be very careful and to speak words which are pleasing and at the same time truthful. So Lord Shiva is aware that if his wife will go there to this yajna, her father may do something which can cause offense. Now Sati's thinking, well, even he gets angry at me, it's okay, I can tolerate. Yeah, she could tolerate, but Daksha's mood, he wasn't angry at Sati. His problem was with her husband, with Lord Shiva. And Sati has great respect for her husband. She worships the feet of her husband, Lord Shiva. So when she went there to the yajna and Daksha ignored her, she didn't worry about that. But when Daksha did the yajna and didn't make any offerings to Lord Shiva, that was too much. When she saw her father's offensive attitude towards Lord Shiva, she thought, I don't want a father like this. I want to give up this relationship. And that was why she committed suicide. She performed sati. She brought the fire out from her body and burnt her body to ashes. So Lord Shiva, he could understand, you know, if Sati goes ahead and goes there to this function, definitely something will happen. So he's trying his best to persuade her not to go. He wants to protect his wife from the situation. But, you know, women, sometimes very independent, strong desires, a lot of attachment, you want something so badly, you can't control them. So what can he do? You know, you can't put her in a prison, lock her in a room, keep her, you're not going. Can't beat her, you're not going to go, I'm not going to let you go. No, he's trying to speak words, philosophy, giving examples, giving words, giving good instruction to her. But sometimes the instructions, you know, the words, they just doesn't make any real impact on the heart. We see also like Kashyapa and Aditi. When Aditi wanted to get the heavenly planets, to get her sons back, her children back into the heavenly planets, she approached her husband Kashyapa because she knew her husband's very powerful. She asked her husband. So Kashyapa tried to preach to her. He tried to give her instruction. You know, don't be attached, you know, it's just the nature of time. Sometimes we're successful, sometimes not. We have to tolerate the difficulties which come. Don't worry about it. You know, a lot of nice words, but it wasn't enough for Aditi. No, come on, I want my children back here. I want the demigods. I want Indra to come back. So then Kashyapa tells, okay, you have to do this, you have to perform tapovrat, this payovrat, drink the milk and worship Vishnu. And then the result was he got Lord Vamanadeva and Lord Vamanadeva. So like that, just giving instructions, you know, philosophical instructions is not always enough. You have to actually do it. Just like Prabhupada said, when he was a little child, they had an electric fan, and it was not very common to have an electric fan. So Prabhupada saw the fan moving, and he wanted to touch it. And father was telling him, don't touch it, don't touch it. But Prabhupada describes, I was a little boy, and I wanted to touch it. My father was saying, don't touch it. What happened then? He got a stick or something, and he put it in the pan, and the stick got numb. So, you know, father was telling him, don't touch it, but when he actually put his hand, tried to put it, then of course he got hurt. So his father said, go ahead, touch it again. No. Yeah. Touch it one time, you get hurt, and don't touch it again, right? That's called the School of Hard Knocks. The School of Hard Knocks. Just like sometimes you walk through the forest and there's a lot of bale fruits, and if a bale fruit falls on your head, it's pretty painful. You know, bale fruits are not like coconuts. Coconuts don't fall on our head, but bale fruit can fall on your head. Especially, we've all got these bald heads, you know. So the bale fruit falls on the head. Wow, it's really painful, you know. So you know the bale fruits are going to fall. You don't go through the forest where there's a lot of bale fruits, right? Because if one's going to fall, one falls on your head one time, you won't do it again. You won't risk it again. The same way, you get hurt on the, you hurt your leg one time. Oh, there was this, the one devotee in Melaka, he was telling me, he said, I used to be a very fierce football player. But he said, no, I'm crippled. My legs are all crippled, you know. So many tough tackles, you know, he got injured. So he said, I'm telling my children, don't play football. He won't let his kids play football. He said, you can go and run, but don't play football. Look at me, you get injured, you can hardly walk, you know. So like that, you learn, sometimes they have to learn the hard way. So here Sati also, although Lord Shiva is giving her good instructions, but it's not enough, you know. She's going to have to learn the hard way. She's going to go ahead and go there and for herself and see for herself, and then that's it. And gives up her fun. Okay, any comments, questions?
Why
Okay. Can I, what, to the deities? Circumambulate?
Yeah. Prabhupada did it, and also the disciples are doing it. How might I understand this nature of devotion? See, can't circumambulate, because they're showing that circumambulation is done outside the temple.
Well, you can understand that the mood of devotion is greater than the rules and regulations. The mood of devotion. And Prabhupada, just like accepting Guru Puja in front of the deities, also, that's another thing. But Prabhupada didn't worry so much about these things. He considered more the mood of devotion more important than the rules and regulations. Because he's a pure devotee, and so Krishna doesn't worry so much about some small discrepancy. Just like, I think there's some verse like that, it's quoted by, is it Madhavendra Puri said, "Oh, my morning oblations, oh, my prayers to the forefathers, all this, oh, my morning bath," so many different rules, so many different injunctions, things we're supposed to do. I can't do that, I'm sorry, I can't, because I'm remembering the Supreme Lord, and I'm worshipping the Lord. So, given up all these, I haven't done all of these other things, but it's not important, because I'm worshipping the Supreme Lord. That's the important thing. Not just simply, you know, niyamagraha is there in the Nectar of Instruction. Too much attachment to rules and regulations. And at the same time, something neglecting rules and regulations. Both are condemned. So, we can think of it like that. Rules and regulations are not as important as the mood of devotion, in the interest of devotion. What do you think? Let them kill it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, let them kill us. Yeah. Prabhupada said, he was telling about how some yogi was in the desert and he killed a dog and ate the dog. But Prabhupada said, "I would rather starve." Prabhupada told Hare Krishna, the one devotee, to go to the communist countries, and he said, "Well, there's nothing to eat there in the winter time. They all have to eat meat." So Prabhupada said, "Then eat meat, they're cool." Huh? For preaching. That's right, for preaching you can do it. Muslims,
Any other question?
Okay, Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai.
Jai.
Srila Prabhupada.